Good morning, everyone. Hope you have gone through whatever I have covered in the yesterday's class. The most important thing being referring the IS 456-2000. So whatever I have covered in the yesterday's class, once again I am going to just brush through it. A quick brushing will be done now. So yesterday I defined a beam, and also I mentioned about the different types of beams. Then I started discussing about the general specifications and practical requirements necessary for the design of beams. In this general specifications, I covered there are five important things that have been listed, out of which I covered the selection of grade of concrete, the grade of concrete to be used for the design of beams, the grade of steel to be used. These two have to be decided before we go for the actual design process. These two things have been already discussed. So today I am going to discuss about the size of the beam, how you are going to fix the size of the beam. Yesterday I mentioned the importance of fixing up the size of the beam. Once you fix the size of the beam, you can arrive at the value of the dead load acting on the beam, which comes around sometimes 40% to 50% of the total load. The total load acting on the beam consists of the live load plus the dead load. So the dead load can be calculated only if you know the size of the beam. So the first thing which you are going to design, the first thing which you are going to do whenever you design a beam is to fix the size of the beam. Size of the beam means it consists of the width of the beam as well as the depth of the beam. This size of the beam depends on the architectural requirements. You cannot go for a large depth beam so that it doesn't look nice. An architect always has an upper hand regarding the fixing of the size of the beam. You have to give respect to his suggestions. So based on this aesthetics or architectural requirements, you have to fix the depth as well as the width of the beam. You cannot have a wide beam, or you cannot have a very small thin beam, or sometimes he may ask for a very slender beam. In that case, you have to go for a slender beam. So like that, aesthetics is very important. So the very first thing which we consider while fixing the size of the beam is the aesthetics or the architectural requirements. Next, further, the placing of reinforcement. So giving lot of weightage to this aesthetics, further you have to think about the placing of reinforcement. For example, if the width is very small, like 150 mm, nowadays this is the size which is normally used, so that the 6 inches wall, the concrete block wall, can be constructed below this and there won't be any offset. Suppose you go for a 230 mm thick wall, 230 mm width beam, and if you go for a wall of 150 mm, then there is an offset seen at the common surface of contact between the wall and the beam. So this should be avoided, and normally in practice what we do is we see that the thickness of the wall is same as the thickness of the beam, so that both of them they flush and there won't be any offset seen at this. Architect never says to do this. He always demands this particular thing where the width of the wall should be equal to the width of the beam. So once you fix the width of the beam like 150 mm, the next thing which you have to think about is the placement of reinforcement. Suppose you are getting around 6 bars like this of 20 mm. 6 bars of 20 mm means 6 into 20, that comes to 120 mm. So you very well know that there should be a cover of 20 mm on either side. So the total width of the beam becomes 170 mm. So one should always remember the placing of reinforcement, or one should think whether the reinforcement that you are going to derive, the reinforcement you are going to design, the number of bars you are going to fix, whether it fits in this particular width of the beam. So the placing of reinforcement plays a very, very important role. Further, this is as far as the width is concerned. Also, I am going to tell you about the check for lateral stability, the lateral buckling that is going to take place in the beam later when I take up the problem. That is another important criteria that has to be kept in view while fixing up the width of the beam. And regarding the size, while fixing the size, one more important thing is about the deflection. So a beam, if it is very long and you are going to have a very small depth, in that case it bends, or there will be large deflection in the beam. So in order to avoid this deflection, one has to increase the size of the beam. So the deflection also plays a very important role while fixing the depth of the beam. So taking into account the deflection criteria, one has to fix the depth of the beam. So for a very large beam of 10 meter span, you cannot go for a small depth beam of around 300 mm. You have to go for a larger depth of the beam, which I am going to speak in another 5 or 6 minutes. I am going to give the method of fixing the depth based on the deflection criteria. So deflection also plays a very important role while fixing the depth of the beam. So like this, I have discussed around 3 points. One is the architectural requirements, next one is the placing of reinforcement, then number 3, deflection. Coming to the moments, again, if there is a large bending moment, then based on this bending moment you are going to arrive at the depth of the beam. Later on, again I am going to teach this while designing the beams. So your depth of the beam should be sufficient enough to take care of the large moment that is coming on the beam. So moments also plays a very important role. Further, the shear, which is always very large at the support, also plays an important role. You very well know that the shear force is very large at the supports. Yesterday I had written a diagram of the variation of the shear force diagram for a simple support beam with uniformly distributed load. So here you can observe that the maximum shear is at the support. So this shear force also plays an important role as far as the fixing up of the depth of the beam. So in order to develop sufficient shear resistance, the shear stress developed by the beam should be sufficient enough to take care of the shear caused by the external load. In that case, depth plays a very important role. So this, I think Professor Suresh might have discussed about the nominal shear stress acting on the beam, which is calculated by taking the reaction coming at the support, where usually it will be large. So we have Vu divided by B into D. So this D plays a very important role. TOSI is the permissible shear stress, and your TOV, the nominal shear stress, should be less than TOC, the permissible shear strength of concrete. In that case, we provide nominal shear reinforcement, and if it is greater than TOC and less than TOC max, we are going to provide, or we are going to design the shear reinforcements. So, what I would like to now stress is, D plays a very important role as far as TOV is concerned. I am going to deal with all this TOV, greater than TOC, etc., nominal shear reinforcements, all those things later, but right now I am interested in telling you that the shear also plays an important role while fixing up the depth of the section. And finally, the economy of formwork. Usually formwork of standard sizes are available, so you have to now fix the size of the beam in such a way that the formwork sizes available is, the formwork is available in the market. Suppose you have 210 mm width, the bottom of this, suppose you sell at 210 mm width beam, the bottom plank should be 210 mm width. That is not normally available in the field. So you have to go for the sizes of the formwork which are available in the market. So like this, while fixing up the size of the beam, you have to take care of the architectural requirements, the placing of reinforcement, the deflection criteria, the moments, shear and economy of formwork. All these things I am going to discuss later when I take up the problems on the design of beams. In addition, one should also be worried about the clear height available below the beam. Suppose you have, normally the height of the building is around 3 meters, and if you provide a beam of 1.5 meter depth, then there won't be any headroom available below the beam. Out of the 10 feet depth of the beam, out of the 10 feet height of the room, half of that will be covered by the depth of the beam, so that you get only 1.5 meters as the headroom or the clear height below the beam. In that case, you have to just bend your head and pass through this beam. So it is not advisable. So the depth is very important. The depth below the clear height below the beam is very important while fixing up the depth of the beam. So nowadays, because of the AC requirements, the AC duct will be provided below the beam, and you cannot go for any depth you like, so you have to consider this particular point also. And further, the width of the wall below the beam, as I already explained, also plays a very important role. So the commonly used widths are 4.5 inches, that is around 115 mm, 6 inches thick, that is around 150 mm. The 115 mm thick wall, if you are constructing, normally brick masonry has got a thickness of 4.5 inches, that is 115 mm, then you are going for a beam of 150 mm width. And if you are going for a 6 inches concrete block, then the thickness of the wall should be 150 mm. Like that, if you are going for a 8 inch concrete block wall, a concrete wall of 8 inches thick, 8 inches width, you have to go for 200 mm width beam. Then as usual, we have the most commonly used wall, that is the brick masonry wall of 230 mm and the other one being 300 mm. So these are the commonly used widths of the beam in practice. So now I discuss about the different specifications to be taken into account and the practical requirements that are necessary for the design. So I said that there are 5 things which are very important. Number 1, selection of grade of concrete. Number 2, selection of grade of steel. Number 3, size of the beam. The 4th important thing being the cover. The last one being the spacing of bars. What is this cover? I think this has been already explained, but once again, since it's very important, I am going to explain it. Cover is the certain thickness of concrete provided all round the steel. For example, if you take a beam, I am reading the cross section of the beam. Let us assume that we are providing 4 bars of steel like this. Let B be the width of this beam. Let capital D represent the overall depth of the beam. So then what is this cover? For all our calculation purposes, for deriving the expressions for the moment of resistance, etc., we use the effective depth. So this is important structurally for the calculations, etc., but over and above this effective depth, certain amount of concrete has to be provided all round the steel bars. So this is known as the cover. This thickness of concrete provided all round the steel is known as the cover. What is the use of providing cover? Cover is provided to give adequate protection to steel against corrosion and other harmful elements present in the atmosphere. So, the definition of cover is, it is certain thickness of concrete provided all round the steel. And further, the purpose of providing the cover is to give adequate protection to the steel against corrosion and other harmful elements present in the atmosphere. So, there are certain governing rules which are to be followed while providing the cover. The very first thing which I would like to stress here is, cover shall not be less than the diameter of the bar, so that it gives adequate protection to the steel. Adequate protection is necessary because any harmful elements present in the atmosphere is going to attack the steel and there will be corrosion of the steel, which will finally make the concrete or the reinforced concrete to deteriorate. So now, the amount of cover to be provided has been clearly mentioned in table 16 of IS 456. Cover is the distance measured from the outer surface of the steel to the outer surface of concrete. Cover is nothing but the distance measured from the outer surface of the steel bars to the outer surface of concrete. That is a clear cover I am referring. So, table 16 of IS 456 mentions about the cover to be provided based on the durability requirements. In table 2, the different exposure conditions are given. The different exposure conditions being mild, moderate, severe, very severe and extreme. For a place like Mysore, we say that the environmental condition is mild. In that case, a nominal cover of 20 mm has to be provided. That is the minimum cover that has to be provided whenever the structure is exposed to a mild environment. Later, if you go to the extreme condition or very severe condition like coastal areas, for example, in Mangalore, the environmental exposure is very severe or it is extreme in the sea coast. In that case, in order to increase the durability of the concrete, you have to provide a cover of 50 or 75 mm. So that's how you fix the cover. So now please understand that the cover mainly depends upon the durability requirements. So for a mild exposure, the cover is very less, whereas for an extreme exposure condition exists, then the cover is very large. In the other condition being the fire rating, the fire resistance. Nowadays you very well know that fire is gaining lot of importance. So your structure is to be fire resistance. So in order to increase the resistance of concrete or a structure against fire, the cover plays a very important role. If you want to have a resistance of around 0.5 hours and the beams are simply supported, then the cover to be provided is only 20 mm. For columns, it is 40 mm. Like that, depending upon the fire resistance which is measured in hours, you have to decide the cover. For example, if you take the last line there in the table 16A given by IS 456, if you refer the last line, you can observe that if you want your resistance of concrete against fire as 4 hours, if you want your concrete to resist fire for 4 hours and if your beam is simply supported, then the cover to be provided is around 70 mm. So like that, based on the fire resistance required, one has to fix the size of the cover. For different elements like beams, slabs and columns, all the details are given here as well as in the previous table which I had shown, where I had mentioned about the nominal covers. So this is the last part of the general specifications which one should know before we go for the actual design of beams, the spacing of bars. After all, your design is nothing but the determination of the width of the beam, fixing up the width of the beam and the fixing up of the depth of the beam, or deriving the width and depth, and finally arriving at the amount of steel required. Your reinforced cement concrete consists of concrete, plain concrete with steel bars. So steel bars, you are going to arrive at this number of bars to be used. So AST, the amount of steel, tension steel, AST, the amount of compression steel, all these things you are going to derive by using the formula for any kind of beam, for any type of loading, and then you are going to fix the spacing of bars. There are some governing rules which are to be followed while fixing up the spacing of bars. So now, already I have written a figure here. In this figure, I have shown 4 bars, means I have done a design where I have got 4 bars of 12 mm to be provided. So this is the requirement that has been obtained from the design of beams. So 4 bars of 12 mm has to be accommodated in a width of 150 mm. Can I place these 4 bars? What should be the minimum distance to be provided between these 2 bars? Already I discussed that there should be both bottom cover as well as the side covers. Leaving the side covers, what is the distance available between these 2 bars? Let us calculate that. So here we have got a width of the beam as 150 mm, out of which I am going to deduct a side cover of 20 mm on each side. 20 mm on this side and 20 mm on this side. Then there are 4 bars, 1, 2, 3, 4. This occupies a space of around 12 into 4. So totally this will be around 110 minus 48. So 110 minus 50, let us say, it comes to around 60 mm. 60 mm divided by 1, 2, 3 spacings. So the distance between 2 bars, the clear distance between the bars, between any 2 bars is around 20 mm. Can I provide this steel? That is my question. So you cannot at your whims and fancies fix this width. You cannot simply at your whims and fancies fix this width. One has to follow some governing rules given in the code. The code clearly says that the minimum horizontal distance shall not be less than the greatest of the following: the diameter of the bar or nominal maximum size of the aggregate plus 5 mm. For this simple case which I had which I have written a figure here, let us assume that I am providing a 20 mm downsize aggregate for my concrete. Let us assume that I am using M20 grade concrete, where let us say that we are providing 20 mm nominal size aggregate. Please understand that in this particular concrete, the maximum size of the aggregate used is 20 mm. All these other aggregates are lesser than this nominal size of the aggregate. So, 20 mm size aggregate is being provided, and according to your code, it says that the minimum distance shall not be less than the diameter of the bar or 5 mm plus 20 mm, that is 25 mm, whichever is greater. So, the greatest of these two have to be picked up as the minimum spacing to be provided between the bars. So, in this case, the cover shall not be less than 25 mm, but however, in the example which I have shown here, the distance between the two bars is coming to around 20 mm. The distance between any two bars is coming to around 20 mm, but the code specifies that the minimum distance as 25 mm. So, you cannot adopt this particular configuration. Instead, you can go for a higher diameter bar so that you get greater spacing and your greater spacing, and so that you satisfy the requirement given by the code. All these things are there in order to control the cracking as well as to see that the concrete completely surrounds the steel bars. The jelly has to pass between the two bars. Suppose you provide a configuration like this, the concrete may not pass through this two bar. There was no space for the concrete to surround these bars. You very well know that in reinforced cement concrete, the concrete should be fully surrounded by the steel should be fully surrounded by the concrete. So, in order to transfer the stresses, they should have sufficient bond strength between the concrete and steel. We assume that there is a perfect bond between the concrete and steel. So, we require the presence of concrete around the steel. If you do not provide this minimum spacing as specified by the code, there won't be any space between the two bars. So, this requirement of the spacing of bars has to be followed, and this you should know before you design the beam. So, the code, once again I am going to repeat this, the code says that the minimum horizontal distance shall not be less than the greatest of the following. Number 1, the diameter of the bar. Number 2, 5 mm plus nominal maximum size of the aggregate. So, calculate these two, calculate the spacing using these two criteria, pick up the greatest of the following, and that is your minimum horizontal distance to be provided between the two bars. So, the spacing of bars plays a very important role. Coming to the vertical spacing, again I will go back to a figure. Not only the horizontal spacing is important, but also the vertical spacing is important. Let us take a beam like this. Sometimes we may provide the steel in two rows. So, when you provide the steel in two rows like this, what should be the vertical spacing between the two bars? This is a case where this is done when you are not able to accommodate the bars in this particular width. You may have chosen a very large size bar, but the amount of steel required is very large. So, that the number of bars required is also very large. So, in that case, since you are not able to provide the bars in the same row, you are going to have the bars in two rows. So, whenever you provide the bars in two rows, again one has to follow the guidelines given in the code, where it says that the minimum vertical distance is the greatest of, number 1, 15 mm. Three criteria are given. First one is 15 mm. Number 2, maximum size of the aggregate, assuming 20 mm down size aggregate, the maximum size that is 20 mm. Number 3, maximum size of the bar. Let us say that we are using 25 mm diameter bars. All these 6 bars are of 25 mm diameter. So, based on these 3 criteria, you are going to calculate the vertical distance and pick up the greatest of the following, greatest of the 3 here shown as the vertical, minimum vertical distance. So, like that, whenever we provide the steel in 2 rows, you have to be careful about the minimum vertical distance to be provided, and the code clearly says, once again I am going to repeat this, code clearly says that pick up the greatest of the following. Number 1, 15 mm, number 2, maximum size of the aggregate, number 3, maximum size of the bars. So, one has to give lot of importance to all these things. Now, once you have understood the general specifications, where I discuss about the selection of the grade of concrete, the grade of concrete should be such that it has got sufficient strength as well as it is durable. Okay? Then I discuss about the selection of steel, and then we discuss about the spacing, cover, size of the beam. So, the different aspects that has to be kept in view before we design the beam is the selection of grade of concrete, the selection of grade of steel, size of the beam, cover and spacing of bars. So, once you understand, once you have understood this general specifications and requirements to be followed for the design of beams, let us now go to the next part of the syllabus, that is the general aspects of serviceability. What is this serviceability? Serviceability is something connected with deflection and cracking. Your beam or your structural member may be having sufficient strength, it may not collapse, it may have sufficient strength, but still it may not be serviceable. There may be large excessive deflections, there may be large excessive cracks. So, all these things have to be kept in view while we design the beams. So, the deflections, the cracks, the vibration, all these should not be excessive, they should be well within the permissible values. So, the general aspects of serviceability I am going to cover, where I am going to deal with the deflection as well as the cracks. Now, what happens if there are excessive deflection? If the beam is subjected to excessive deflection, what happens? It may not collapse, but it spoils the appearance, it affects the partition walls, floorings, there will be lot of cracks in the walls as well as in the floorings. All these things will lead to the discomfort of the user, and we say that the structure has reached its limit state in serviceability. The moment I say that it has reached its limit state of serviceability, we say that it is not useful. The structure becomes unuseful, means it has as good as collapse. Okay? So, like that, the serviceability limit state should be taken in view or should be considered while designing the beams. And further, while designing this beams for serviceability, certain load combinations have to be considered. The IS 456 table 18 gives the details of the partial safety factors to be used while checking the limit state of serviceability. Already Professor Suresh might have explained the meaning of this partial safety factor in continuation with that, once again I am repeating this, while checking the limit state of serviceability, different load combinations to be considered and corresponding partial safety factors have to be taken into account. So, this table 18 given in page 68 of IS 456 gives the details of the load combinations to be considered along with the partial safety factors to be considered for the limit state of serviceability design. Now, the next topic is the limit state of serviceability for flexural members. You very well know that our beam is a flexural member. So, while checking this limit state of serviceability of beams or flexural members, as I said that two important things are there in this, number one the deflection and number two cracking. So, one has to check the beam for deflection as well as for the cracking. What is this check for deflection? The IS clearly mentions about the check for deflection as well as the check for cracking. So, once you design the beam for collapse, once you design the beam for limit state of collapse, the next thing is you have to check for the limit state of serviceability. Always we design the beam for the limit state of collapse and further check for the other limit states, but normally for normal conditions we check the beam for the limit state of serviceability, where two important things have to be kept in view, kept in mind, that is the deflection as well as the cracking. So, the IS 456 clearly gives two methods for the calculation or for the check of deflection. For the control of deflection or for the check for deflection, it gives two methods. One is the empirical method, the other one is the theoretical method. So, today I am going to discuss about, in the remaining part of my lecture, I am going to discuss about the check for deflection based on empirical method. So, whenever you want to check the deflection or you want to know whether your deflection, the beam suffering is under control or not, we have got two methods. Number one empirical method, number two theoretical method. So, I am going to now discuss about the empirical method. The very first thing here is to calculate the actual L by D ratio. This empirical method used for the control of deflection or for the check of deflection in any beam, first of all demands you to calculate the actual L by D ratio. So, what is this actual L by D ratio? Suppose you have a beam, just I am taking a simply supported beam. Let us say that the depth of the beam is 300 mm. Let us assume the effective depth as 275 mm. Let the span of the beam be equal to 4000 mm. I think by this time you should be able to calculate the actual value of L by D. Actual L by D ratio, the slenderness ratio has to be calculated. So, in this simple example, the value of the actual L by D is 4000 divided by 275 mm. So, whenever you are trying to check the deflection based on the empirical method, the very first step is to calculate the value of the actual L by D ratio. This actual L by D ratio should be less than the allowable L by D. A very simple method for the check of deflection, the empirical method is very simple as compared to the theoretical method. So, in this empirical method, I am going to first of all calculate the actual value of L by D, compare this with that of the allowable L by D. If this actual L by D is lesser than the allowable L by D, we say that the beam is safe against deflection. So, now the question is how to calculate the value of the allowable LBD ratio. So if you open this IS 456, if you refer this class 42.1, all these details are given. However, I am going to just mention about the method of calculating the allowable LBD for any beam. So this is based on the slenderness ratio. The IS code clearly gives the basic LBD ratios for various kinds of beams. For cantilever beams, the allowable LBD is 7. The basic LBD is 7, whereas for simply supported beams, the basic LBD is 20, and for continuous beams, the basic LBD is 26. So to calculate the value of the allowable LBD, one has to pick up the value of the basic LBD from the IS code, and this basic LBD ratios for different types of beams are: number 1, 7 for cantilever; number 2, 20 for simply support beams; number 3, 26 for continuous beams. So once you pick up the value of the basic LBD from the IS 456, the next thing is to calculate the value of the allowable LBD. Allowable LBD is nothing but equal to basic LBD, allowable LBD ratio is nothing but equal to basic LBD ratio. Already I have mentioned about this. There are only three values that are there for this basic LBD. Number 1, LBD equal to 7 for cantilever; number 2, LBD equal to 20 for simply support beams; number 3, 26 for continuous beams. So once you have picked up the value of the basic LBD, the next thing is you are going to get the value of allowable LBD by multiplying this basic LBD by the three factors MT, MC and MF. Now the question is where to get these three values, MT, MF and MC. So MT is nothing but the modification factor for the tension steel provided. MC is again the modification factor. MC is the modification factor for the compression steel. MF is the one that has to be used for the flange sections. So now I am going to explain with the figure. So let us consider a beam. I have written the cross section of the beam. In this beam, let us say that I have provided a tension steel. It is a simply supported beam. So for simply supported beam, you very well know that steel is going to be provided in the tension zone, which is below the neutral axis. So this is the amount of tension steel provided. Let us also assume that there is some compression steel. Let us say that we have used a compression steel of ASC and we have used a tension steel of AST. Let the width of the beam be equal to B. Let the effective depth of the beam be equal to D. So now with the help of this values of AST, ASC, B and D, one can calculate the value of PT. What is this PT? PT is nothing but the percentage of tension reinforcement used, and also one can calculate the value of PC, the percentage of compression steel used. PT can be easily calculated with the help of this AST, and PC can be easily calculated with the help of AC. That is, for a cross section of B into D, the amount of steel provided is AST. For 100, it is how much? So PT is nothing but equal to 100 AST divided by B into D. In the similar fashion, PC, the amount of compression steel, is nothing but equal to ASC into 100 divided by B into D. So, once you know the values of PT and PC, with the help of these values of PT and PC, you are going to get the values of MT and MC. Where do you get these values of MT and MC? So, MT is obtained from figure number 4 of the IS 456. If you open this page number 38 of the IS 456, you can get the value of MT. A typical graph I am going to write. Please open this page number 38, where he gives the values of the modification factors MT for the amount of or percentage of tension steel used. There is a graph like this. So, this graph shows us the details of the modification factors. So, along the y axis we have MT and along the x axis we have PT. These are the values of FS, and in the graph itself he has mentioned about the method of calculating the value of FS. FS is nothing but equal to 0.87 Fy multiplied by the amount of steel required divided by the amount of steel to be provided. So, this is clearly shown in that particular graph, figure number 4 of IS 456. So, once you know the value of FS and once you know the value of PT, you can easily pick up the value of MT. So, MT can be picked up, and that has to be used in the formula which I had earlier written to calculate the value of the allowable LVD. Similarly, we have one more graph, that is graph number 4, graph number 5, where he gives the values of the modification factor for the compression steel used. You know the value of PC, and if you know the value of PC, you can calculate the value of MC. Similarly, graph number 6 gives the values of MF. MF depends upon whether it is a rectangular section or whether it is a flange section. So, for the ratio of web width to the width of the flange, so on the y axis we have the reduction factor, which I am calling it as MF, and along the x axis we have BW by BF. So, for any value of BW by BF, one can pick up the value of the reduction factor to be used. So, figure number 4, 5 and 6 are very important in order to calculate the value of the allowable LVD. So, now coming back to this formula to be used to calculate the value of the allowable LVD, you can observe that it is nothing but equal to the basic LVD multiplied by MT into MC into MF. So, once you know this, once you calculate the allowable LVD, the governing rules states that the actual value of LVD should be always lesser than the allowable value of LVD. So, once this condition is satisfied, we say that the deflection criteria is satisfied. So, another note can be observed here. Whenever the spans of the beam are more than 10 meters, one more factor has to be considered, means whatever the formula there given shall be multiplied by 10 by span in meters. So, if it is a beam of 12 meters, then you are going to multiply the whole thing by 10 by 12 to arrive at the value of the allowable LVD. So, I think with this, let us once again brush up, go through quickly whatever I had done in the today's class. So, today I started with the general aspects of the general specifications and practical requirements necessary for the design, and later on I touched upon the general serviceability requirements, the general aspects of serviceability requirements, and I covered the empirical method to be used for calculating or for checking the deflection. So, in the tomorrow's class I am going to cover the remaining things, that is the theoretical method And later on I will be discussing about the cracking, and further we are going to work out some problems on this deflection and cracking. So that will be the checking for the limit state of serviceability. Later on the same thing will be used in the design of beams.